This is a magic lantern. The technology basically goes back to the time of Da Vinci, who looked at the effects of light coming in through a small hole and illuminating a room, which he called camera obscura. In the time of Galileo onwards, some of them worked out how to invert this camera obscura effect to have a little room with a light in it projecting what's inside out onto an exterior wall, which is basically how cinema was born. This technology was developed by Sir Charles Wheatstone in the 1860s, 1870s, before photography, before film. These were as popular as televisions, and they're 3D, you know, and you'd get your cards and you'd put them in and look around and check it out. That piece there is a little homage to the man himself, Wheatstone. And as you can see in here, that's a little model of his telegraph system. It's nice to be able to have a look at the larger history of something, and you can see perhaps from its early evolution through to now allows you to see where it might be going next.
At the Australian Synchrotron, I'm a member of the Accelerator Physics Group. What we do is make the accelerators work to generate high energy particles, which in turn generate high intensity beams of X-rays, visible light, infrared, which in turn gets used to study atoms and molecules. So we're at the heart of the Australian Synchrotron, generating these bright beams, which are used by other scientists from a really broad field to study new properties of materials, medical imaging. In order to generate that light, you need to generate high energy electrons. So we need to accelerate these tiny little particles to almost the speed of light. It's one of those odd things that the smaller the object that you want to study is, the more energy and the larger the machine is.
The magnet is now ramping over.
We can actually squeeze the beam down to about a picometer, so that's an unimaginably small subdivision of a meter, and that means that per unit area the intensity of the X-rays that are generated from our beam is many, many billions of times brighter than the sun.
In 2005, I made this sort of pinball machine, which was based on Einstein's theory of relativity, and it was 100th birthday of his theory. And I exhibited that here before they'd built this in here. And then I got a 3-month residency to kind of have a play around with the synchrotron.
Chris came into the Australian Synchrotron on the Synapse residence as an excited little kid, really.
I was absolutely overwhelmed. They took me into the tunnels and I actually had nightmares, I think the first night, and I was just kind of drowning in this sea of cables and wires and infinite amount of variables.
He pretty much got carte blanche to come in and play with the scientists and with the machine. And a lot of the stuff he did initially was quite literal, so people had told him this is a light source, so he brought in a light bulb and played around with his light bulb in our light generating machine, and then that evolved to become something a bit more nuanced. People got very excited about seeing their experiments and their life's work represented the way that Chris could represent them.
I work with the energy that is in here and coming out of here, and even though it's light, most of the spectrum is such frequencies that you can't see it, it's invisible, it's poisonous. So I have to do various tricks to try and visualize these invisible fields and forces. The light almost becomes like sound, because in here it's all about frequencies and harmonics and just trying to get the right harmonic to make it all work. That's what they call the synchrotron tune. And so I've also been playing around with the tune, trying to visualize that.
Just a HTML5 and a cascading style sheet.
Yep. Something good and works.
Yes, look at those now, electrons getting captured in the...
Yeah. If we look at the page source...
In fact, technically they are doing that, but the recoil momentum is so tiny that you...
Yeah. It's sort of what like one molecule difference.
Chris would take some object, some peak of data, some bit of light, and look at it from many, many different angles that often I don't have the luxury to look at it from many angles.
Looking at Mark as the scientist, he's kind of like 99% science, but one little bright spark of a percent of artist, which is why I think he wants to sort of, you know, develop these things and see where they go. This sort of very high-end physics modeling software, you know, we've used to literally make art with. That was just some very basic stuff we're playing with, you know, saying, okay, can you make this number affect that? So now that that's set up, in theory...
The principle is simple.
What could possibly go wrong? With the scientific project, it's often quite clear. You need to achieve a certain performance or you want to make a certain measurement. With the art, it was never that clear. We would maybe aim for something, but then we would meander and we would lose track of what we were doing, or we would get another idea and it was a bit more rambling.
You end up in a place where, you know, even for a physicist, he doesn't know what he's doing, and he's literally improvising, and it's almost like free jazz to sort of see what he tries to do, and then I'm like, oh, let's try this, and then he's like, okay, blah, blah, blah.
Now, it might look for that. Working with Chris, I felt that freedom, and it allowed me just to let go, I guess, and not worry too much about the deadlines and the timelines.
This piece, which is called The Time of Glass, is inspired quite directly by the optical diagnostics workbench at the synchrotron, where they, you know, get a beam of light and split it up and do various tests. Kind of recreating some of Newton's experiments in here too, with prisms, but also various test tubes and bits of glass to capture the light and refract it and reflect it in ways that creates this glass light labyrinth around us. Years ago when I was young, I could see that there were these two worlds that were so apart, but on one level they were so similar, and I always wanted to be the first artist to win the Nobel Prize in Physics.
One of the great things about working in a science lab like this is that it does attract a lot of people who are interested in the unknown and interested in the mysteries of the universe. So having people around to, you know, a few sigma off the normal distribution helps the creative process.